like a plan. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back live on the Philippe Matthews Show. We've got her back, Dr. Louann Brizendine, one of the world's leading neuropsychiatrists, author of two New York Times bestselling books, The Female Brain and The Male Brain, graduated from in neurobiology from UC Berkeley, attended Yale School of Medicine, and completed her residency in psychiatry at Harvard Medical School. Welcome back, Doc.
Thanks for having me back, Philippe. It's good to be here on the holiday season.
Absolutely. Today is a pivotal topic. We're going to be talking about the sexual harassment brain, understanding white male privilege, learned helplessness, and female silence. Now, let's talk about unpackaging that.
That's it. That's definitely a big tamale, so to speak. But let's take it back let's take it back into kind of like how little girls and females come of age in a way. Let's talk about that kind of like developmental curve in terms of what that experience is like. Because I know you as a guy, you know, you probably have heard pieces of that, but you haven't like lived it. So
nope.
Let me help you and your audience kind of think about about how that unfolds and what's going on there. So, you know, and let's talk a little biology because that helps us understand the psychology, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's take, you know, little girls, 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old little girls. They, you know, running around playing, being normal little girls for the most part. And, you know, they are in a stage of development that we call childhood, right? Just mm-hmm. as little boys are. So it's the pre-puberty. They haven't started the rock and roll of hormones. It's going to take over pretty soon. So in that stage, they're you know, they are doing whatever the heck they want. They may be playing with dolls, they may be playing computer games, maybe playing sports, you know, as little boys are doing what they do. And we know that they like to do different things, and usually little girls prefer to hang out and play with little girls, and little boys at that age prefer to hang out and play with mm-hmm. little boys. They call it sort of self-segregation of the sexes. They don't necessarily, I mean, they'll play with each other a little bit if there's nobody else, but so
right.
You know, coming up on for the little girl, by age 8, 9, 10, what starts to happen is that the pituitary in your brain and your brain hypothalamus start to wake up and start to produce some little hormone surges that ping the ovary. It pings mm-hmm. the ovary. Wakes up the ovary and says, hello, maybe time for a little estrogen coming on here. So, you know, the ovary starts leaking out a little bit of estrogen, usually about 2 years. So the brain goes into puberty 2 years before the body.
Mm, interesting, okay.
So if you see, we mark age of puberty in girls by the age of onset of menstruation. It's called menarche. It's when the period starts, when they start their period. So mm-hmm. average age is 12.1 or 2. African-American girls are about a year earlier, so they're about 11 on average. Caucasian girls on average are about 12. Asian girls about 13.
Why is there a difference?
I think it's important to kind of know that it's like got this ranged, and we don't know why. Biologists kind of don't know what that's about. We think that, you know, the Asian girls tend to be a little bit slender and have fewer fat cells than, say, Latina or African American girls on average, just the way our genetics are. And so the brain won't allow you to go into puberty unless you have enough fat cells to potentially support a pregnancy. It's just how the body is built.
Fascinating.
If the girls in the wild running around in, you know, like in the forests of Brazil or someplace in the Serengeti in Africa, you know, places where you don't have easy access to lots of food like we have, the average age of onset of your period isn't until 17. So what biologists think is that it's pushed it down to age 12 when you have as much food as you need and you can build fat cells. So that's where we are in our culture. And as childhood obesity becomes more and more, girls that are chubbier end up going into puberty earlier. So anyway, we're going back into that brain again, right? So that 2 years before, so if the girl is going to start her period, let's say at 10 or 11, then by 8 years old, 8.5 or 9, her brain is starting to ping the ovary and say to make a little estrogen. And if you want to just visually look at a little girl, and we call them breast buds. You know how the breasts just start making that little tiny puffy area in little girls, sometimes by 8, 9, 10, 11. That means that estrogen is coming out of the ovary and stimulating breast growth. And so that's usually 24 to 18 months before they start their period. So you can kind of gauge it and guess when it is. That's why people grab my book and they like to read the teen girl brain chapter, chapter two. The teen girl brain chapter is like about how
like help.
It's usually dads. The dads used to come in the bookstore and even get they would buy a cop six or seven. The guys, why are you, you know, 40-year-old guys buying all these books? Oh, me and all my friend, we've got our girls are 12 and 13, and we don't know who they are anymore. We got to find out. We want the roadmap, baby. We need the roadmap. Anyway. So anyway, the roadmap is in that 15-page chapter in the teen girl brain. Anyway, that this is how the biology all comes down. And so the reason I take you through that for the little girl is that, you know, so her body is starting to, and then lots of moms will notice that the girls get maybe just a little bit sassier with them, you know, by 9, 10, 11, and maybe a little bit moody because, you know, it's as the body is having the brain and the pituitary stimulated, the estrogen is going through some of its cycles. And of course, when the actual first period hits, that means that the brain and pituitary are communicating well with the ovary and it's starting to do the regular hormone cycle of girls. So average age is, say, 12 for girls. About 20 or 30% of girls, though, will start their periods by 9.5 or 10, especially if they're African-American girls. So by the time they're third grade or fourth grade, which most teachers don't know about. So there's this time period in there when they're still little girls, but their body is starting to develop. Just as a counterpoint to boys, between ages 9 and 15, boys' hormones, the testosterone in boys, goes from a small level of like 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 level to like up to 3 or 400. So it goes up like times 25.
Wow.
It's like a hockey stick. It goes boom, wham. You know, between age 9 and 15. So you guys, you dudes are like, your testicles start making, you're just marinating your whole body and brain with that stuff, you know.
Wow, amazing.
So then we measure puberty onset with boys by the age of the first wet dream. And that usually ends up being about 13.5.
Okay.
For Caucasian boys, and it's probably a little bit younger for boys. You know, it's I'm not sure that, I don't know whether there's as much data for the Asian boys being a little later and African-American and Latino boys being a little younger. It depends on your body size and your fat as well. So, but at any rate, that testosterone comes up like a hockey stick. So at any rate, what that does in the male is it starts running all that circuitry in your brain that, you know, from the moment of conception, if you have a Y chromosome, you're going to be a boy. And by 8 weeks of fetal life, the tiny testicles in the fetus are pumping out huge amounts of testosterone that marinates the brain, turning into two male brain circuits. One of the things it does is it increases the size of the what's called the area for sexual pursuit.
Interesting.
To 2 to 2.5 times larger in the male brain than in the female. So your guys, you have a natural growth of your area for sexual pursuit in your before you're even born. And then not till this age 9 to 15 when your testosterone is going off the charts, that's the fuel that runs that circuit for area for sexual pursuit. So, you know, young guys in their 12, 13, 14, they start having like every pair of breasts that walk by gets their attention. You know, oh yeah, you're grinning. So I know that guys, when I tell, you know, you guys usually, I don't know if that's light, but you guys, every guy.
I'm never going to say anything. I'm never going to tell the truth. No, but yeah.
You would check that box, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so it's like, and it's weird because it's like all of a sudden it's like, and I remember, you know, I was writing that part of the male brain book when my son was about that age in high school. I'd say, well, hey, I'd drive into the hamburger joint. I'd say, hey, dude, listen, I know you wouldn't really have this conversation usually with your mom, but let me tell you, I'm writing this part of my book and I'm trying to figure out kind of what it's like, you know, for guys your age. He was like 13, 14. Guys your age, when girls come to school and they are in kind of, you know, in the summer, they're in those bikini tops and they're in whatever and whatever. He goes, oh, mom, well, guys my age, when that happens, it's like you can't take your eyes off of them. So that sort of said it all, right? It's like he pretty much. He's going like, I'm thinking like how distracting that is in a class. It was like, I'm thinking, oh my God, you know? So at any rate, I was like flying the wall with my son at that age. It was very kind of him to tell me what you guys are thinking. So that's what's happening in the male brain. All that testosterone flies, like every female body part is like all of a sudden of interest. Whereas 3 years ago, you didn't even notice girls existed. They were maybe just your sister and they were annoying or whatever. So I just, the reason I set this discussion that we're having today up with this is that this is the natural way. I say, God, she made it that way. So we would all like procreate, right? So the male is supposed to pursue the female for, you know, impregnating the female. So we have the species continue. And so this is how our natural body and brain is wired. Girls at this age, at 12, 13, 14, they are the ones who are going to be pursued. So while the boys are having this big flood of like sexual fantasies and sexual thoughts and wet dreams, all the stuff that you guys go through in puberty, girls are going through, they would like to be a female that a male would like to pursue. Do you know? It's like, so it's they're going shopping for the right clothes and it's the hair and the makeup. And it's not like that for all girls, but you watch this happen all of a sudden. Parents watch this with their girls. They're all of a sudden interested in how to look, whatever. Mm-hmm. They're posting pictures of themselves that, you know, they're doing selfies, all the stuff that they're doing, you know, they're comparing themselves with all their peers. They want to know if they're competitive in the market of being a female of interest. You know, so this is happening in 10, 11, 12, 13-year-old girls. I mean, this is what fills up, you know, their heads. They are going to be the ones who are pursued by the males who are out there pursuing. So this is nothing weird. This is just how the biology makes us. So I want to start from the foundation of how our biology has us all wired, okay? And then, of course, girls start to watch the interest to, as their body develops and they grow breasts, they start to notice that males are noticing. And if it's a peer, a same-sex, same-age boy or something, a peer that's noticing or whatever, you know, that's one thing. But they also get noticed by older men and older guys. And is a double feeling about that. It's like, ooh, wow, I get all this attention. And wow, people are noticing me, you know? So there's a side of it that's a nice feeling. And like, you feel powerful, you know, as a female to like be able to draw this attention to yourself. You know, you haven't quite gotten the idea that they're not really interested in you.
Right.
They're interested in your female body parts.
And that's a big distinction. That's a huge distinction. And the fact that their brains are still developing, so they don't know how to process all of those other emotions.
Exactly. And I think we as a society fail our girls and boys at this age. You know, the educational system don't want to touch this. Parents are really don't quite know where to go with this. You know, churches and religious, like, they, you know, the kids learn this stuff by the School of Hard Knocks now in the media, I mean, or on the web, you know, on their Snapchat, you know. And it's at a very young age, but like you say, the reasoning part of the brain, of the teen brain, just to give you an idea of like, the part of your brain right behind your forehead is called, you know, the prefrontal cortex, and it's where reasoning happens. It's where you make plans for the future. It's where you make an assessment of if a behavior that you might do might have bad consequences. Mm-hmm. That part of your brain.
Is that also the spot of your moral compass, if you will?
Yes, your moral compass, but it's offline. It is not. It's not myelinated. It's not come online until age 19 for girls and age 21 for boys.
Wow.
So, I mean, it's not completely offline till then, but it's not fully, fully developed. And mm-hmm. I think that's why rental car companies won't rent you a car till you're 25.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you pay a big surcharge or something.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever, but it's a, you know, they've assessed. I mean, that's a funny kind of societal assessment of when you can be expected to be responsible and make decisions that know about consequences. So I think that here we are, we're talking about 12, 15-year-olds, right? That age group. And we're talking about their brain wiring for how to make a decision about something that your behavior, the consequence it will have or not have, isn't going to be developed till you're 19, 20, 21.
Mm-hmm.
That gap is our responsibility as a society, in my mind, to fill. And we are doing a horrible job of it for biology.
Well, does that research and data, or not necessarily the research and data, but the lack of understanding or respecting that research and data, is the reason we have such a high teen pregnancy rate?
Well, I think that, so, you know, the only place kids get any of this education is sort of in a health class often, where they might teach in some schools about the menstrual cycle, ovulation, contraception, pregnancy, you know, it might teach about that. But there's, you know, a huge variety in that for all kinds of reasons across the country. That's got to do with, you know, political things that shouldn't even be involved in that. We should just teach the facts, and then, you know, and the facts should be known by kids and help them make judgments about that. Because you see, if we were all in the wild and didn't have quite enough nutrition and weren't having our periods till 17, we weren't able to get pregnant till we're 18 or 19. That would be consistent more with when your brain, you know, it would be a different world. But because we've had such good nutrition and we are having girls start their periods at 10, 11, 12, they can get pregnant at that age. There's a whole home in LA for pregnant girls between the ages, wait for this, between the ages of 9 and 13.
Oh, wow. I had no idea.
So,
wow, that's scary.
So the biology and the body and pregnancy works whenever you know,
mm-hmm.
the girl's having her period, she's, you know, and you know, whatever age it's start, you know, so I just give you that because that's a startling piece of information for,
yes.
especially for most guys, because you don't know a 9, 10, 11 year old can get pregnant.
Unbelievable.
And those are often because of sexual abuse. Those cases are because of someone in the family or someone known to the girl is getting access to the girl, and it's,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
it's incest or rape or sexual, you know, it's all bad news usually.
Sure.
When you've got a 12 or 13-year-old in one of these homes for pregnant girls.
Yeah.
So I think that, so, you know, I'm thinking that we're trying to think about together here fully today, just how all the biology works, and then how we as a society want to help protect our kids and teenagers in a way that allows their brain to get developed enough that then they can have 18, 19, 20, the brain circuits to be able to make good decisions. And, you know, They don't want their parents in their stuff at 13, 14, 15. They push mm-hmm. you away like mad at that age. So they're giving the message like, I'm fine. I'm, you know, I'm out there. I'm, mm-hmm. I'm ready to rock and roll mm-hmm. on my own. I really don't need you parents or adults. I don't want you. Get out of my face. Right. That's how the attitude is. But actually, they really need us even more because they're big enough, strong enough, able enough to go out there and make some mistakes that could ruin their lives, you know, going forward. So I think our societal responsibility is to help protect kids, especially between the ages of 12 and 18. That's a big pull. I think boys clubs, girls clubs, you know, all kinds of, you know, the after school sports program, there's all kinds of things that can be helpful, but we there were, so going back to the girls and feeling this feeling of like male eyes on you or on your body parts and on this is, you know, can feel kind of interesting and new and fun for a while. But then, you know, it gets to a point as you get older and older and you get hit on by older guys or you have inappropriate touching or inappropriate, you know, propositions or inappropriate behavior, even predation by older men.
Yeah, let's get it. Let's talk about that, because this show came about you and I talking about during the presidential election. One of the candidates came out. There was a videotape that came out with basically him saying, you know, I grab women by the, you know what,
P word,
and that, by all description, is a sexual predator. And that was one of the conversations that we had. But we also kind of blended in not just sexual predator, but also white male privilege and what that means and why women remain silent for so. And, you know, this has been in the news, in the media, in many different cases, why women stay silent and remain silent for sometimes decades, sometimes their entire life. So after making the connection between the neurobiology and the hormonal aspects of our kids, of our teens, and protecting young girls who become young women and become women, what is the sexual harassment brain? How does that manifest itself in men versus women?
So, you know, the we go back to that part of the male brain with all that testosterone starting to run the sexual pursuit circuitry in your male brain, which is, you know, Mother Nature's way of, you know, getting you guys to go out and, you know, do your job of procreating, you know. However, if you think about how in male culture, young male culture, there might be, the kind of group, you probably were in some groups where it would be one guy that would start making comments, and then other guys don't want to be seen as being what they call males. They call males the P word too, right?
Yep.
You don't want to be a wimp, you know, you don't want to be seen as being gay or not one of the, you know, all of those things.
That's one of the things we talked about in the last show about the power of the brain, how it doesn't want to be ostracized from its peer group. In the teen brain, it's probably more powerful and palpable than any other part of life, because you can, you know, kind of move yourself from one group to another. But when you are a teen and you're around your peers, holy cow, you do not want to be looked upon as an outsider.
Holy cow, it's right. You do not want to not be part of your little gang. And I use that word. I mean, that has the word gang can, it really feels they are your kin. They are your family. You do not want mm-hmm. to be ostracized from that group for a lot of reasons. Because if you got singled out, you might be ostracized, bullied, humiliated, mm-hmm. And extruded from the group. And like we talked about last time, in the human brain, both males and females, in the human brain is the tightest circuitry that we have is to keep connections with our group. Mm. It could be our family, it could be our peer group at that age, at the teenage, Our peer group to us is everything. That feels like life and death, the world to us. And if we get extruded from our group at that age, it is like death. It is horrendous. So you don't want to do anything that might get you ostracized and kicked out of your group. And when it comes to young teen boys that are making sexual jokes or fun or whatever of females, you know, you're not, if you think your group is, that's what your group is doing and you're not liking it so much as one of the guys, you'll go along with it. I mean, it's going along with something that's not going to be ostracizing you is something that's probably quite normal for you to do.
And is there a difference though hormonally to have as a teenager to have what now has become a phrase as locker room talk in your teens versus in your 70s?
So the locker room, if you think about your testosterone level by the time you're a guy is 19, 20 years old, is probably just the numbers. Your levels may be up to 700, 800, 900, 1,000. By the time you're in your 70s, that level may be down to 200 or 300. Mm. So it's, you know, it's a slow decline, but it can, you know. So your circuits as a 70-year-old are not being fueled by like high testosterone all every second of every day. So, you know, there's a different, so I think that, you know, George Bernard Shaw, one of his famous statements when he turned 81, he says, oh, finally, I'm not driven by that. You know, I feel I can finally think again, you know, I can finally, right? It's this, you're smiling, you know, it's like, finally, I can, oh, what?
So what? How do we connect that then, Doc? With you know what? You know, I as we were talking about in the green room, I've been in classrooms and I've been around kids and their families and they're coming saying, I don't want to have this conversation with my child to hear this word, to even know what that is. And the news media and social media is raising my child before I get to.
Yeah, like the P word is like all the
same. Yeah.
Everywhere.
Oh my gosh, what's going on here?
Right.
But, you know, is there a different brain wave or hormonal load that denotes sexual predator, sexual harassment? And there is a difference between predator and harassment, but you know, the two are, you know, kissing cousins in a sense.
Yeah, I think one of the things, I mean, there's two very different pockets, and we should take the two separately that we're talking about. You know, we're talking about the issue of like, I want to raise my kids before the media raises my kids and talks about the P word before they're even ready, you know, because you want to teach your kids at a stage when they're ready to hear things. Then you're talking about the other issue of like, having a person in power over either his female employees or his, I mean, it could also be male on male or female, and it's not always just let's talk about the power differential is a big piece of this. And, you know, I think when one of our presidential candidates was basically saying, I'm rich, I'm famous, I'm powerful, I can grab a woman by the P word whenever I want, you know, I can go out and shoot someone in the streets in New York and nobody would ever even, you know, it's we're talking about power and basically then being able to do with other human beings whatever the heck you want. So
we're talking about the narcissistic brain as well then.
Yes. And so from a female's perspective of that experience, there's not very many females that you talk to who haven't had the experience of being in a situation where there was a male in power, they're a female, and the male is wanting either sexual favors or wanting or implying that they do or making inappropriate sexual comments in the workplace, or or touching behavior, or and my generation of females who went through medical school, we all have, we all have our stories about mm-hmm. how that went with a male, one of our male doctors or our male supervisors that was in charge of whatever it was. And they don't see themselves as preying on you. They felt that it was completely all right. Then all of the sexual harassment laws came in, and everybody had to take these little courses before you could get your medical license renewed. Lots of cases got hurt. So since my era in medical school in the late 70s and 80s, and now, there's been a lot of education in the professional world that you have to go through, and lots of lawsuits. So things actually have shifted there, that making just throw off sexual jokes in the workplace is just no longer tolerated. And the younger generation basically is having, fortunately, less of that. Mm-hmm. And yet every female will still tell you that they're, females are smaller and weaker by and large. And, Madonna came out last week and stood up in the award that she got, and she talked about how she was raped at knife point on the rooftop of her apartment in New York City, and she described, the numbers of women who have actually been raped in our culture is in the 1 in 3 women have had some sexual abuse episode of some kind in their lives. That's a heck of a lot of women in this country. So I think men don't, it's like that. So 1 in 3 women you will meet, Philippe.
And that's what's just being reported.
Yeah, and that's probably, it's considered to be, a little bit underreported. So I think that women get used to being on guard. Mm. And it's something you learn over time with episodes of things that have happened, and you learn to be on guard and be silent. I remember my advisor in medical school, who was the head of the promotions committee, would grab me on the way out of my session with him, which was one-on-one, and kiss me on the lips on the way out. And this was in the day when you didn't say anything.
Mm,
so wow. I just stopped making ever any appointments with him. I just stopped calling, forget sure. that. But for me, so I've had that experience where a powerful man that had my promotion in his hands did some stuff that was inappropriate, and I didn't ever say anything because there was no way to say anything. So now there's become ways in which that would be something that there would be someone to go report it to,
mm-hmm.
which is, is a good thing in institution that has happened. But that's not everybody has that happen in an institution. You could be a boss in some place that you're working that's whatever, and things have become a little bit less, you have someone to go talk to. But the issue of female silence comes up, female silence, even in marital relationships, there's a power differential there, and the number of women who are, forced into sexual things in a marriage that they don't want.
Mm-hmm.
Women don't actually talk about that, Philippe. It's not talked about. So it's not just, Donald Trump out there saying that he can grab pee anytime he wants or do whatever he wants with a woman, but that power differential and the strength differential and being captive in a situation where you are the less powerful one is something that a majority of women have experienced sometime in their life. So mm-hmm. let's just put it out there and call
so
it what
talk
it is.
To give us the understanding, because it wasn't until I had a conversation with you that I even heard the term female silence. Talk to us about what female silence is and explain that to us so that men who are going to be watching this show can also get an understanding of what that means.
And so females, I bet you that all the men watching your show out there, if they turn to the female in their life or some female that they have a trusting relationship in their life with, and they just ask the question, has you know, have you ever had an episode where you had a man do something, say, or be inappropriate with you in a sexual way where he was in a situation of more power, you know? If you just ask that question to them, they may sit and think a minute about it, and they'll come up with something that you think you know that person. You've never heard of that before. Mm-hmm. But when it's, and it's not because they're actively hiding something from you, you know, it's just that it is just one of those things that women have normalized.
Mm.
And the silence doesn't come, I mean, it's a weird thing, right? It's the silence doesn't just come from like pushing it down and putting it in a lockbox because it's so humiliating and embarrassing and shameful that you can't talk about it. It's just that it's so frequent. It, by the time you get to be a certain age, you've had so many of these episodes that sadly, women have normalized this stuff.
So is that normalization another term for that? Would that be a part of learned helplessness or a concept of that?
And they have learned that basically that this is what's happened, and that there's nothing you can do about it, quote unquote. There's nothing you can do about it. And sometimes women just push it down so much for so long, and I think this is where women, like, if it happened to you in your teens somewhere, right, or your early 20s when you're young and most powerless and also most sexually attractive, I mean, and then 10, 15, 20 years later, you stop normalizing it because something, you've lived on the planet and you've learned that what happened to you was not all right.
Mm-hmm.
What happened to you was sexual abuse. What happened to you was rape. What happened to you was what's called a near incest event, or a teacher, you know, or a predator that preyed on you type of event. You don't name it. You're not able to name it till 15 or 20 years later for all kinds of reasons. You can't name it. And you can't name it if you're still in a vulnerable, non-safe position with that person.
Mm-hmm.
You've finally gotten in a position where you've maybe gotten some therapy, gotten some help. Maybe you've become a more powerful person in your own world, and you start to realize that something that happened to you then in your late teens and or your 20s was absolutely not all right, and that you were a victim of something. Whereas the female silence and helplessness piece is that you learn to just normalize it and keep it quiet. In the course of your things happening in your life, you didn't elevate it outside of your own silence to yourself, Philippe. Silence to yourself.
Wow, that's very powerful. When I think about something else that would continue to trigger that self-silence and that learned helplessness is in today's culture, everything is so litigious that even if you do later in years come out and talk about it, you might end up financially devastated. Because you're going to end up being sued by the person who sexually harassed you or assaulted you. And if they have that power and privilege back then and they have it now and you do not, you're still a victim. You're victimized twice or continuously. It just never ends.
Right. I mean, you think about at least the stories that are out there in terms of the accusations that one of the candidates actually, you know, raped teen girls in this kind of situation in New York where someone was procuring young teen girls right off the boat from Europe or something. And there are all of these allegations that, you know, but those, and some of those girls were coming forward, but, you know, they were slapped down with like gag orders and, you know, who knows, you know, it's a powerful person can still shut you down.
So is there such a thing as, well, we know about the term hypermasculinity. Is there a hormonal connection to this hyper masculinity and what's known as white male privilege?
So we were talking about the male brain's testosterone level and the area for sexual pursuit. And if you think about males, so the one thing in psychology that we know for sure is the biggest difference in the male and female group is the area of what's called aggression. 20 times males versus females. And not anger, remember, anger is, the two sexes have the same amount of anger, but the anger going into physical aggression is 20 times 20 in males over females. And if it's sexual aggression, if you're already, and the one correlation in males who are in, they put them in five categories of males who have levels of testosterone, for example. The very highest levels of five, and the next group is a four, three, two, and one. It's like your levels of testosterone. If you're running very levels of high testosterone and you have a lot of aggressivity, you know, then sexual aggressivity, you can think of that as being more biologically prone to mm-hmm. that. And if you've never had any reason to have anybody slap you down or any, there's no, you know, if you've been maybe in all boys schools forever, if you've all been, you've been around, you know, the male locker room thing where everything was okay and you could get away with everything because you were a powerful male and nobody turned you down, or, you know, there was always an outlet for that, that where you didn't get, you never got any consequences to.
There's no accountability.
Sexual male aggressive behavior. Then you can see how that could be really someone who's a powerful male who could be a sexual, you wouldn't even have to call him almost a sexual predator because he's got, it's become, he's normalized that to like what's his due in life, what he deserves in life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's why, you know, it's kind of like white male power, privileged, rich males have this. And one of the things that males in that category feel is that one of the reasons they do everything they do is so they can have sexual access to as many beautiful, sexy women as they want.
Mm-hmm.
You're a male. That's one of the reasons you want to be powerful and rich and have that is to have access to all the females you want, to like a harem. You know, it's an old male wiring.
Well, it's fascinating because I've had Dr. Badalore, Jacqueline Badalore on several occasions, and she's an amazing historian and anti-racist does amazing anti-racist work, and we constantly talk about the anti-miscegenation laws of 1681 and why they were one of the main reasons that they were created even before the founding of the country and the Constitution was that white privileged males in power wanted to have exclusive access to women because there was not enough women, if you will, to go around. There were more males than females, and a lot of the females were attracted to and choosing other men other than the powerful rich men. And so they created these laws that gave them, these anti-miscegenation laws, that gave them exclusive access to white women. Oh, well, to all women, but particularly to white women. And if we go back and look at that from the legal, the governance aspect of America, you are now giving us the actual neurobiological reason behind that, and why we are the way we are and where we are in this country in so many aspects, in so many ways. Absolutely fascinating.
And so I think what you're talking about is it's helpful to understand the biological wiring, and then it's also important to understand what the role of society is to control those basic primal urges that we all have and how we're wired. Because without the rule of law and without human rights, without consequences and some control on these, they get out of hand. That's what the word civilization means, and it's what groups of people that have laws, rules of laws, morality, religious, if you look at all the religious mandates and rules about sexual behavior and marriage and taking of a spouse, taking of a wife, and how you, I mean, these, the controls of this basic biology that we have is what law is all about even religious law, all if you look at how societies have tried, what they've needed to do, try to keep it so that more powerful males didn't take all the females, more powerful males didn't just have sexual access to all the females, you know, that it's and about, you know, it's just layers and layers and layers of how we as a society and as a religious society or different societies throughout the world have needed to have their laws to deal with this piece of having civilized behavior.
Fascinating. In looking at that, how do we, okay, so you have someone running for president of the United States that has always been privileged. They've never been poor. They've never been blue collar. They've always been highly educated. They had the best of the best in life. They were born as millionaires and became billionaires. When we talk about the social group and the wiring of the brain wanting to connect and stay connected to our social group, but we look at so many poor people, blue-collar workers, laborers, that voted overwhelmingly for someone that they'll never become. Walk me through that, if you could. Walk me through that biology. Is it that there's a level of seduction that goes beyond common sense and logic and reasoning in the brain? The social circuitry part, I'm missing at that level because of the cognitive.
This is a perfect question. Let's take it into two buckets of category.
Okay.
Like the first one, which is very interesting allusion that you're making to, like, this issue of like wanting, he is wanting to be part of his social group or other billionaires, right? That is his social group. Those are his peers.
Those are his other peeps, as we say.
His peeps. His peeps are other billionaires.
Right.
And men of like power. So peeps that are billionaires and peeps that are like generals. He considers his peeps generals and other billionaires. And if you look at who he's got, the 17, 18 people he's chosen so far around him for his inner circle, his peeps are his peers, are all billionaires and generals. So if you look at that issue, like he wants his peeps around him, it's not the poor and the, you know, it's not, you know, so he's chosen his peeps. So that's one thing that we should be clear about what's happened, what we've been watching happen. That's very clear. The other piece that you ask about is why would all of these people in the country that voted for him, that were working class and poor people, how can you understand why they would be appealing to vote for him? So let's look at that for a minute. And I'm gonna tell you a little tiny story of, I was visiting my sister who works in Vegas back about 9 or 10 months ago, and I got in a taxi cab to go to the airport, and I needed to go to a store first, so he took me there, whatever. We had a lot of time to talk. And he was a immigrant father of 3 or 4 kids, but you know, a grown-up guy, maybe in his late 50s. And we were talking about the election and all this stuff, and he goes, I just really, you know, I really think this Trump guy is going to be great for us because, you know, Washington is broken, and he's a good businessman. He's a good businessman because he's rich. No, he is a good businessman, and he will go in there and he will know how to run this country in a way that runs it like a business and makes it a successful business, so people will have jobs, things will go good because he knows what he's doing. He's gonna go do this. And he's also rich enough that he doesn't need the salary of the president. Do you see the thinking though?
That's like, fascinating to me, because no president has ever needed the salary. to be present. But I understand the psychology, what you're saying. Yeah.
I remember feeling that back way when Rockefeller was running, way back when. I thought to myself, I mean, I'm from, you know, kind of lower middle class origins, and we didn't have any money either. So I was thinking, like, that would be good, you know, because he wouldn't be incentivized by needing the salary. You know, it was. But I know that thinking, Philippe, is also that. Here's this guy that could also.
So it's the neurobiology of hope.
Yes, the hope. He doesn't need the money. Also, that he doesn't need that the president, that this guy Trump doesn't need the money because he's already rich. So. Do you see the thing, and that he's a good businessman, so he can go running and go fix what's going on with the broken business of Washington. So, and also, so it's basically hope. We're going to pin our hopes onto someone we can think is going to be a hero. He's already successful, and we already, you know, it's name recognition, already successful. The brand of Trump is known, you know. So I think that it was all about, we know Washington's broken and it's not working well, and we want someone to go fix it who's not incentivized by the big giant salary of the president.
Wow. That, and, I'm not making fun of, it's just overwhelming to hear it.
Does it ring true to you?
Well, no, it doesn't ring true to me. I'm kind of at another place and stage, actually from our previous conversation, understanding this. But this is this is new. This is the first time I've heard this reasoning behind that level of social. I guess that level of social group. I guess it's the social group of hope versus.
No reason about it. It's all gut level hope.
Yeah, that because it's just it's mind boggling.
And the other candidate has like all the dirty laundry of the other candidate. All the dirty laundry of her. She's already corrupt. We want someone who's fresh and we can hope for.
Interesting, fascinating. That is fascinating. That is a fascinating piece. All right, let's go back to connect the dots. To sexual harassment and both the male brain and the female brain. Now, in the female brain, well, not just in the female brain, but particularly in the female brain, we know of this process called trauma bonding. And trauma bonding is when you are, in a sense, in an abusive situation or being taken advantage of, and either you can't get out or that there's a level of seduction that you keep going back to, that you become addicted to the trauma, and there's this bond. You know it's wrong, you want to get away, but you can't. And something happens, there's a divestment or something happens in the brain where, and I assume this is where the learned helplessness comes in, that you know you're being abused, whether that's at work, at home, at your with a family member, somewhere, and whatever the level of sexual wrongness is, whether that's, you know, as low as harassment and words or slurs being thrown at you, to actual being, you know, beaten and raped. What is it in the brain, in the female brain, that creates that that trauma bond?
So the human brain wants to bond. You know, our first bonds are with, like, let's say our mother as the core bond of attachment. We get someone that we need because we're helpless to take care of us and bond with. And when you get older as an adult female, you're getting a lot of your attachment bonding needs with your whoever your lover is, and that can end up even being an abusive relationship. Even in that case, the person would rather have that attachment bond to someone who at least is there to help provide for them in some kind of food, clothing, shelter type of way, whatever that is, and get some kind of attachment, love, attention, whatever that, even if it's just like a kernel of that, even if it's just a fantasized kernel of that, you go back and back and back to that if there is no alternative off-ramp to that. So it is very core human brain circuitry to keep that attachment bond, even if there's a dangerous, abusive piece of it, they'll put up with that piece because the other core piece of the bond is there, of being like taken care of, or fantasy, the food, clothing, shelter, or protection, whatever that happens to be. If this person is isolated, has nobody else to turn to, has no other escape, that is the only place they're going to get any of their needs met, even if it includes a piece of abuse that's would be intolerable to any of us. That person has no escape. They are helpless, but they go back because it's the only bond they have. They don't feel they have any alternative that they can count on.
Fascinating. When does it become almost like Stockholm syndrome versus a trauma bond? When does it move into that disorder arena?
So all of these disorders, you know, are like the Stockholm syndrome and the disordered bonding and the attachment disorder and the, you know, these are all pieces of like little pockets that things kind of go off and form kind of a syndrome. We call them syndromes now. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, to heal someone from that is a long process, but the first thing that you have to do is have this person get to a place of safety, where the safety is safe, 1, 2, and 3, top things, safety, and they have to come to really believe in their safety away from that person. That's first, and it could take years that they need to be safe away from that person for them to start to heal and to trust anything or anybody else, even to trust themselves, Philippe.
Wow, that's very powerful. So going back to your personal assessment of what happened to you with the taxi driver, going back to this concept of this white male privileged hope, if you will, that because he's a good business person, because he doesn't want to take money to be paid to be the president, that he's going to run the White House like he runs his billion-dollar business. In that context, how should mothers and fathers who have girls, what should they say, and how should they approach their daughters, and I guess their sons too, that we have an example of a sexual a harassment or a sexual predator. We have an example of white male privilege. And that regardless of how many insults there are to ethnic groups, to religious groups, to war veterans who have been captured, regardless of how this person views women and rates them on a scale from 1 to 10, help me with, as a parent, making that correlation between, well, he's a great businessman and he's going to get Washington together, versus kind of who he is in terms of character. And how do you transfer that to a child? Because that child now thinks it's okay. To the boys think it's okay to have that level of ignorance and bravado. And the women, the girls, get proselytized and conditioned to think it's okay to be treated that way.
I think you said it very well, Philippe, that this tension between that and the moral compass of the country, the moral compass of the person who leads your country, as a role model for parents and role model for children to look up to, is something that people are having your minds in a pretzel about it now. All of us are. Where on earth do you go with that? How do you parent in the context of something that you believe yourself to be an anathema to everything you've worked your entire life, say, as an adult, to try to move against, and now all of a sudden it's taken power?
Mm-hmm.
It feels like a horror movie.
Absolutely. There's so many messages that are being sent. I mean, we're looking at an individual who has 5 children from 3 different wives. What one of the things, especially as an African-American male, as a melanated male, one of the things that we have a difficult time understanding is, and I respect what I'm now going to call the cab driver's understanding of why, you know, like the labor and the poor white people who think that, you know, this guy is a great business person. What I'm trying to get an understanding of is, does that supersede all moral character? You know, we're dealing with someone that their photo is going to be in put up in every school. And for, you know, not sounding crude, but just factually, his wife, I can search on the internet right now and find nude photos of his wife. That there's something wrong with this. There's just something not right about it. And, you know, what in terms of our brains, so that we won't try and make this the new normal, as we were talking about earlier, or normalizing it. I don't want to get into a learned helplessness to normalize this type of behavior. And not just behavior, but this is a lifestyle.
Oh, yeah.
This is a lifestyle for these people. So it's not something where it's a gaffe, you know, where they made a wrong statement, they apologize for it, but there's no kind of history of it. This is a lifestyle that these people have lived. And
they think is normal.
They believe
it's normal.
Yes.
I saw a little thing today where it says, it had a thing of George Washington. It says George Washington could never tell a lie. And then it had one of Nixon. It said could never tell the truth. And then one of Trump that said could never tell the difference.
I love that. You've got to send me that.
The reason I put that out there in the context of what you're just talking about and what you're struggling about and what a lot of the country is struggling with is, how are we going to hold the space of not making this the new normal?
Yeah.
How are we going to resist making it the new normal? How are we going to hold a space that's different in what we teach our children and what we teach and hold for our community as the values that we hold, and not have the pull towards the new normal that it's bound to have when you see that face everywhere in all the schools and you see the face everywhere on the media all the time? How are we going to hold something that the gravitational pull is going to be to make it the new normal? How do we give pullback and continue with our lives? How do we hold a space where we're not making it the new normal and continue with our lives in a way we feel is consistent with our, what I call, our moral true north, our moral true due north for ourselves? How do we hold that space? And the only way, as we've talked about a lot on this show before, that we hold a space like that is we surround ourselves with a community where our community is reinforcing that with each other, that we are due north, and that is not the new normal for us. And that for that, you need to have other like-minded people who are with you, and they are your community, because that's the group that you want to bond with and you want to keep yourself in that and you're not wanting to be pulled off into this new normal. You must surround yourself with a community that is supportive of the moral due north you feel in your heart and soul.
I like that. So that is that also the message that we need to send to our to our children, particularly those mothers out there, single mothers in particular, who are raising young girls, and single fathers out there raising young women, that they need to create a defense shield of high quality people.
They do. Around them. They do, and they need to be very cognizant of who they're letting their children have access to, and you know, they need to be able to keep their community that has this due moral north that's not going to get pulled to this, to making this other thing the new normal.
Wow, we started out asking how can you know start out by unpackaging all of this, and. That's a lot of luggage we just went through. That was amazing.
We covered the waterfront, and then some.
And then some. Closing thoughts, statements on moving forward as we end 1 year and begin another one.
I think that one of the things we need to do in the terms of female silence and this issue of having, you know, female empowerment and women having their voices heard, is that we need to basically help the women, and you guys really need to be bonded with us in our groups to help us move forward to basically saying we're not going to go back to times when we didn't have reproductive control of our bodies. We're not going to go back to a time when we didn't have contraception. We didn't, you know, you guys, you know, the shotgun marriages of the past, and, you know, it's going to, these things ruin guys' lives too. We're not going to go back to a time when, because of women's reproductive cycles, we are going to go back to a place where you do not have control of your own body.
Fantastic. All right, Doc. I appreciate you. So much. You are a brilliant mind, and you know, let's continue to have these deep conversations, discussions on how making the connection to our how our brains work, and then how we can actualize that and manifest that in our daily lives and society.
Thank you so much for having me, Philippe, and thanks to your audience for their careful attention to what we discussed today.
Absolutely. Stick around in the green room as we have a 5-second delay as we go off and sign off. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Don't forget to comment and share.